Hey guys, Mark here. In this video, we're going to show you how to build experiences for our affordable mixed reality kit Zapbox using Zappark Studio. This simple example will teach you how to track content to the map and controllers of Zapbox, as well as handle the interaction between the two. We won't be covering the setup of Zapbox kit itself in this video, so make sure you've checked out the Zapbox website at zappa.com/Zapbox for more information. Controllers ready? Let's go. To allow us to focus on Zapbox tracking, we're going to give ourselves a head start and use a project I created earlier. In our scene, we have a button, a foam finger, and the Zapper Bunny. These have been placed on a blank target for the purpose of this demo, so we can take a look at them before moving them into the final Zapbox tracker groups. In addition, there's a headset group housing a headset mode icon relative to the screen, which the user will use to enter headset mode. We also have some animations set up in the controllers panel. The button has a press timeline. The foam hand has seen and not seen states. The bunny has a wave timeline complete with 3D text. And the headset button has visible and invisible states. And the orientation states are also used to rotate it. We're now ready to create our Zapbox tracker group, the group that allows us to attach content to the map and controllers of Zapbox. To add a Zapbox tracker group to the hierarchy, we right-click on the root node and select New Tracking Zapbox Tracker. After confirming the name, the tracker group will appear in the hierarchy. Our new Zapbox tracker group is made up of three separate groups, one for the point code map and one for each controller. When selecting these groups in the hierarchy, we're presented with wireframe representations which we can manipulate using the controls in the bottom right corner. For the example we'll be building today, we only need one controller, so we're going to delete the right controller and set the Zapbox controller hand of the left controller group to any. The Zapbox controller hand property lets you specify if the controller has to be the left, right, or either controller to display the content within the group. As the controller group is now set to any, we're going to rename it to just controller. Now we can start moving our content from the blank target group to the Zapbox tracker groups. First, we'll move the foam hand group into the controller and scale and position it to match the size of the controller. Next, we'll move the bunny and button groups into the map and position and scale them. We're making them quite small and close to the center of the map so that this experience will work well on a tabletop. The scale of content within the map group is such that a distance of 1 in the group corresponds to 1 meter in the real world. Since planes go from -1 to +1 in each dimension, a plane with default scale will be 2 meters wide and 2 meters long. Now is a great time to preview our work and check everything appears as it should. With the content positioned and scaled correctly, we can delete the blank target group and begin to set up the interaction between the foam finger on the controller and the button on the map. We're going to do this using trigger regions. Trigger regions are one of the most effective ways of handling interaction between the Zapbox controllers and the map, as they can be used to determine if an object has entered a defined space. In this case, the object is the tip of the finger on the foam hand, and the defined space is the button. We'll start with the trigger region itself by adding one to the button group by right-clicking on it and selecting New Trigger Region. Confirming the name will create the trigger region represented by a wireframe. By default, trigger regions have a cube shape, but we're going to change this to a cylinder in the Properties panel and line it up with the buttons. When scaling a trigger region, it's good to make it a little bigger than the object it's representing, as this makes the interaction a little easier for the user. The other option we need to set is the trigger tag, which will allow us to pair this trigger region with the plane object we'll be adding to the foam hand. As we have no tags created yet, we'll make a new one calling it button. Now we'll move our attention to the foam hand. We're going to add a plane into the foam hand group to act as the object to intersect with the trigger region. The position of the plane determines the intersection point, so we're going to place it near the tip of the finger. The size and visibility of the plane has no effect, so we can scale it down and set its visibility to false. Lastly, with the plane selected in the hierarchy, we can scroll down to the bottom of the Properties panel and set the tag to the button tag we created earlier. 3D model subsymbols cannot act as trigger region objects, hence the need to use a plane. The benefit of this, however, is the ability to fine-tune position. As all of our interactions so far have been defined using states and timelines, we can use actions to tie everything together. The first actions we're going to add are to the controller group, activating the seen and not seen states when the controller fires the on seen and on not seen events. This will hide the foam hand when the controller is not in view and bring it back when it is seen again. We're also setting the enabled property to false in the not seen state so that the trigger region cannot be interacted with if the controller is not visible. Up until now, the seen state has been the default state within the foam hand controller. This allowed us to see the foam hand model when previewing earlier. As we've just set up the foam hand actions, however, we can now set the not seen state as the default state. The reason we want to do this is to make sure that the foam hand model is invisible and inactive before the controller is seen in the camera view. Next, we're going to add an action to the trigger region in the button group. We want to play the button press timeline when the plane in the foam hand group enters the trigger region, so we'll select on trigger enter event and the play timeline action. We also want to play the bunny's wave timeline, so we add a second play timeline action. We're also going to select the from start checkboxes for both timelines, so they play from the beginning every time the user presses the button with the controller. Following that, we're going to set up the interaction of the headset button. Our first step will be to create a headset manager within the headset group, selecting it from the right-click menu. The headset manager is responsible for Zappa's support of headsets such as Google Cardboard and the Zapbox headset. With our newly created headset manager selected in the hierarchy, we're going to add two actions. One to activate the invisible state of the headset button controller when the on headset mode enter event is fired, and one to activate the visible state of the headset button controller when the on headset mode leave event is fired. This will ensure the headset mode button can only be seen and activated when the user is not in headset mode. Lastly, we need to add an action to the headset button to allow us to enter the headset mode when the user taps on the icon. We do so using the onTap event and the enter headset mode action. And that completes this simple Zapbox project. We can hit preview and give it a go. Hopefully, this simple project has shown you how easy it is to track content in Zapbox and add interaction between the spaces. For more Zapbox tracking info, please check out the Zapbox section of our documentation. Thanks for watching.